So this is a joint work with Guillaume Moreau and Damien Stelle, which is my PhD advisor. So let me just start. So there is a lot of words in this title that I'm going to define. But let me just start by giving you the big picture of the talk. So I'm going to be interested in computing short vectors in some structured lattices, some ideal lattices. And I will be interested in trade-off. How short can I obtain a vector compared to how long it will take to compute it. So if you just consider any lattice, you can get this trade-off, which is achieved by the BKZ algorithm, which is a well-known algorithm. And so you can have a short vector in exponential time, the shortest vector in exponential time, or a vector which is 2 to the n times larger than the shortest vector in poly time, and you have all the trade-offs. And so in this talk, I'm going to focus on some structured lattice where we are trying to do better than this algorithm. So there is already some previous work on that by Cramer-Ducas-Peikert-Regev and Cramer-Ducas-Wesolowski. And so they achieve in the quantum setting some improvement here, so they can have a 2 to the square root n approximation factor in polynomial time, so they have some gap here. And so what I'm going to present you is so how to obtain all the trade-offs, because here we just have some gaps, so to obtain the full line, plus also some improvement in the classical game. Okay, so this is just what we're going to do, the pictures. So now let me define a bit.
Could you just speak? Could you step back a minute?
Oh, yeah.
Move your head a minute. No. I can't see the middle one, that's all.
Oh, is this one?
Yeah. Oh, it's fine. Yeah, carry on. Yeah, no. I just needed to see it. You were standing in the way.
Sorry. Yeah, and I forgot to say, if you have any question, don't hesitate to interrupt me, so I'm not sure what you already know or not. Okay, so let me start by defining so the word in the title. So what is the lattice? So instinctively, a lattice is a discrete vector space. So here, the lattice in dimension 2. And so how do we define a lattice? We just take n linear vectors, independent vectors, and we take just integer linear combination. So instead of taking real linear combination, integer linear combination. And so these vectors that are used to generate the lattice, it's a basis. And we can have different bases for the same lattice. So in this example, we have the two blue vectors that are one basis, and the two red vectors that are another basis. And so you can already see that there are some bases that are better than others. So the red basis, we are going to say that it's a good basis because the vectors are small and somehow orthogonal, whereas in the blue vectors are very much longer and they are not orthogonal at all. So why do we care about lattices, and why do I say that it's a good basis? We're going to see that it's when we try to find, so the main problem I'm going to be interested in is trying to find short vectors in lattice. So you are given a basis, which defines a lattice, and you want to find a short vector. So if you already have a good basis with a short vector, then it's easy. But we're going to see that if you don't have a good basis, then it's much harder. So the shortest vector problem, which I will write SVP in the slide, it's this problem. You are given any basis of a lattice and you want to find the shortest element of the lattice. And shortest, because usually there will be at least two shortest elements, because you can take minus the vector. And lambda 1 will denote the length of the shortest non-zero vector. So this is SVP, and so in the title it's Approx-SVP, so the problem is not finding the shortest element, but a somehow short element. So instead of, let's say, you say you choose some approximation factor, so for instance 2, and you just want to find a vector which is smaller than 2 times the shortest vector of the lattice. So this is Approx-SVP, with approximation factor 2 here in the example. Okay, so that's for the first Approx-SVP in the title. Let me also define another problem on lattices that we're going to see, which is the closest vector problem. So now you still have your lattice given by your basis, and you have one target point, which is not in the lattice, it's in the real space spanned by the lattice. And you want to find the point of the lattice which is as the closest to your target. So here it's the red point. And so again, you have some approximation variant of this problem where you just want to find the point of the lattice which is not too far from your target. Okay, so so why are we interested in this problem? It's because currently they are supposed to be hard to solve, even with a quantum computer, so we can use them to build cryptographic primitives which are supposedly post-quantum. So what do I mean by hard to solve? So this is again the BKZ algorithm. So if you take general lattice, so general lattice, the best algorithm we know, so gives you this approximation factors, so we've already seen. Yeah, so basically you have 2 to the n, the sum of the, in log-log space, the sum should be 1. So, yeah, you can have 2 to the n approximation factor in polynomial time. But if you want the shortest element, you need its exponential in the dimension. Yeah, I didn't say n is the dimension everywhere. Okay, and so about the applications of lattices, so maybe you have not heard about the SV problem, but you surely have heard about LWE, because that's what is usually used to build protocols. So here the arrow I wrote means if you can solve LWE or CIS, you can solve the shortest vector problem. So LWE and CIS is harder than finding short vectors in the lattice, and because we suppose that it's hard to find short vectors in the lattice, then the LWE and CIS problems are hard to solve, even with a quantum computer. And yeah, so in fact, we even have the opposite reduction, so these problems are all equivalent. And so usually, yeah, so as I said, the protocols, the primitives, they more often rely on LWE and CIS. I guess it's easier to build protocols on these problems. So we have a lot of applications, more advanced or less advanced cryptographic primitives. Okay, so that's good. We have some problem which is supposedly post-quantum, and we can do a lot of cryptography with it.
What about CVP?
CVP?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, everything is somehow equivalent.
For SVP, it's CVP equivalent?
Yeah. Up to some reduction, I mean, polynomial loss in the size of the parameters. Mm-hmm. But Yeah, so the main problem with everything there is that it's not efficient. And I mean, the main reason for the fact that it's not efficient is when we work with lattices, we have a basis for the lattice, and the basis, it's quadratic in the dimension. But the difficulty, the security, it's only exponential in the dimension, not in the dimension square. So basically, you have to have very large public key and stuff like that. Your public key can be the basis of the lattice, so it will be quadratic in the dimension, and it gives schemes that are not efficient. And so in order to improve efficiency, the idea is let's use structured lattices. So for instance, if I use a lattice whose basis is given by this matrix, so each row is the same as the previous one, except it's, it's anti-circulant. So we shift it on the right and put minus one there. So now I don't need to store n square coefficients to have my basis. I just need to store the first row, and also operations become easier because multiplying such a matrix by a vector is kind of evaluating a polynomial, and so you can do that much more efficiently. It becomes somehow linear in the size of the in the dimension instead of quadratic. And so this special matrix correspond in fact to what I will call an ideal lattice. So for the moment, I'm not going to define ideals yet, but just think of ideal lattices as structured lattices, which are used in order to improve efficiency. So again, if we use ideal lattices, we have structured variants of the LWE and CIS problem, which are called ring LWE and ring CIS, which are harder than finding short vectors in ideal lattices. And you can plug them in the primitives, and usually everything works as with the non-structured variants. So you can have a lot of cryptographic primitives with these two problems, which are harder than finding short vectors in ideal lattices. So now, in the ideal setting, structure setting, we don't have the reverse arrow. So I'm going to come back on that later. And okay, so we have better efficiency for the schemes, but now the question is also, maybe it's easier to find term vectors in structured lattices, because we add some structure to the lattice to improve efficiency, but it also gives more power to the attacker. So that's what we are going to focus in this talk, finding short vectors in ideal lattices. Okay, so as I already mentioned, there is this work of Cramer-Ducas-Peikert-Regev and Cramer-Ducas-Wesolowski at Euclidean 16 and 17. And so what they showed is, if you have a quantum computer, you can find these points, you can find a 2 to the square root n approximation factor in polynomial quantum time. And so here here it's no better than BKZ, but there you have again. So it's a heuristic algorithm, but it's quite usual heuristics. And it works only for some structured lattices, not for all ideal lattices, only for cyclotomic lattices. Okay. Oh, I didn't say that in the first slide. Sorry, I forgot. There is this exponential preprocessing that I think I forgot to say in the first slide. Okay, so I'm going to present you some extension of the CDPR algorithms, where we have all the trade-off, but there is one big but. It is we have some exponential preprocessing that depends, let's say for the moment, only on n. So for each n, you do some exponential preprocessing, and then you can have these times for any lattice of dimension n, any structured ideal lattice in dimension n. But it's not really n, it's more like the field under a limit, but okay, but there is this 2 to the n preprocessing, so I mean, it's there plus.
Is the preprocessing space or time?
Space and time.
Sorry, could you go back to the previous slide?
Yes.
So you have this remark that these results are applicable only for prime power cytotomic fields.
Yeah.
Can you say something about two power cytotomic fields?
Yeah. Product of, yeah, so there is an extension of this work.
Mm-hmm.
I forgot the author. It was in the crypt last year, but I forgot the author. That extends this to power of two product of two prime powers, cyclotomics.
Mm-hmm.
P to the alpha times Q to the beta.
But if you have the order 2 to some power, which is usually applicable in FHE and so on.
But that's also prime power, right?
It's a prime power.
Ah, yeah, sure, sure.
2 is a prime.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah, so that's right.
I know what I'm going to ask during his PhD. What's the smallest prime?
Sorry, thank you.
So usually we work in cyclotomic power of 2, which is why usually people just care about prime power of cyclotomic fields. So this is our result. And so let me just say some words about the impact of this result. So it's really a theoretical result. What we are trying to say is that it seems that maybe in ideal lattices it's easier to find short vectors than in general lattices. But there is two reasons for which there is absolutely no impact on real protocols. And so there is this preprocessing time, which is, I mean, even if you do it just once, it's 2 to the n, so it's not doable. And also the fact that, so I've said that R at W is ring at W. So usually the schemes are not built directly on ideal SVP, but on ring at W, which is harder than ideal SVP, but we don't have the reverse. We don't have the reverse arrow. And so what we're doing here is just saying that this problem might be easier to solve than what we expected. But it does not say anything about ring LWE. So the schemes built on ring LWE, it might be, and it seems that it should maybe be that this problem is in fact easier than this one. So the only thing that we show is that the reduction is not useful because. And so in fact we think, so there is an equivalence between ring LWE and module SVP, which is an extension of ideal SVP. So maybe there is a divide here between ideals and modules. Okay, so that's all I had to say for the introduction. Yeah. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to define what is an ideal. So this will be the first, but I mean, we don't need a lot of stuff, just a very simple definition. Then I will present you the Cramer-Ducas-Peikert-Regev algorithm because our algorithm is just an extension of it. So, and then I will show you how to extend it and conclude. Okay, so for this talk, I'm going to focus on this ring, which is cyclotomic power of 2. If you don't know what the ring or, I mean, it's just, it will just be here, the set of all polynomials with integer coefficients modulo x to the n plus 1. So we can see this as the set of all polynomials of degree at most n minus 1 with integer coefficients. Okay, so I will need two definitions. Units. So the units of the ring, they are the elements that can be multiplied by another element of the ring, and we obtain 1. So if you think of Z, which is a basic ring, the units are 1 and minus 1. And a principal ideal, so I'm going to show you the result for the specific class of principal ideals. It's just a set of all multiples of some element of the ring. So again, if you think of it in Z, it's, for instance, the set of all multiples of 2 is an ideal. And we say that this element, which is used, so I mean, yes, it's 2, it's a generator of the ideal. And we know exactly what are the generators. There will be all the same elements multiplied by units. So in Z, the generators of the set of all even numbers, they are 2 and minus 2, because there is only 2 units, 1 and minus 1. But in more general rings, you just multiply by all the units and you get all the possible generators of your ideal. Okay, so this is an algebraic definition of an ideal. And so now I'm going to consider an ideal as a lattice. So I'm going to see that as a geometric object. So how do I see this as a lattice? So remember that the ring is just a set of all polynomials with integer coefficient of degree at most n minus 1. So I can see that as a vector of dimension n of integers. So you just take all the coefficients. So this is natively a lattice because it's just z to the n. So here in dimension 2, you have in one direction 1 and in one direction x, and it's a lattice. And now if I take an ideal, so here the ideal generated by 2, I get all multiples of 2. It's stable by addition and subtraction, so that's also a lattice. It's a lattice included in the original, in the big lattice R. And so the basis of the lattice will be 2 and 2x, for instance, here. So in the more general case, the basis of a lattice generated by G, it will be G, Gx, Gx squared, etc. Because any element in the ideal will be G times a polynomial with integer coefficient, and I'm just decomposing this polynomial with integer coefficient as an integer times 1 plus an integer times x plus an integer times x squared, etc., etc. So this is a basis. And if I write, it is in a matrix, so G is a vector of all the coefficients of G as a polynomial. Then G times x, I'm just shifting everything. And when I obtain G minus 1 times xn, because I'm working modulo xn plus 1, so xn is equal to minus 1, so I'm just putting my coefficient there with a minus sign. And so we recover the matrix I've shown you at the beginning, the anti-circumference matrix where you just translate a, no, shift a row and add minus 1s. So, okay, so now that I've defined what is an ideal, the problem I want to solve can be just said like that. I'm given a basis of my principal ideal generated by G and some parameter alpha. And I want to find a multiple of G, which is smaller than 2 to the n to the alpha times the length of the shortest vector of the lattice. And so again, this is the trade-off for general lattices. The time will be 2 to the n to the 1 minus alpha, and we want to do it. Okay. So let me start by describing the Cramer-Ducas-Peikert-Regev algorithm. So the main idea of the algorithm is I want to find a short element of my ideal. Maybe the generator is a short element of my ideal. So if we go back again in dimension 1 in the case of Z, and the ideal generated by 2. So this is my ideal, the red points. And the shortest non-zero elements of my ideal, there will be 2 and minus 2. So the generators, they are good candidates to be. I mean, in dimension 1, they are the shortest elements. Now, if I increase the dimension, it's not true like that. But still, we can say that at least one of the generators, so we will have a lot of generators, but at least one of them should be somehow small. So we're going to see that. And so to see that, I will try to make a lot of pictures. And I need the tool, which is the log space, which will be very useful to work with ideals. So I'm just going to define it. There's really not a lot of stuff happening here. So I have a function log with capital L that goes from the ring to R to the n. And you can think of it as taking the logarithm of each coordinate of your vector. So here I will draw what happens in the log space in dimension 2. And I will need, so I define two elements. So one, which is a vector with only one coordinate, and h, which is the orthogonal of it. So now you will have to trust me for these properties. So if I take an element in my ring, I will always decompose it as something collinear to 1, a times 1, plus some element in the hyperplane h. And what we know is that if I'm taking an element of the ring, they are all on the right of my hyperplane. We also know that the ones that are just on H, they are exactly the units of the ring, and they are not just random points on H, they form a lattice on H, which is called the log unit lattice. And so logarithm is additive. If you take the log of a product, it's the addition. This is quite natural. And so now I will only work in this log space. But what I want is short elements in my original space, but in fact it's related because I'm just taking the logarithm of each coordinate.
This is the log of the canonical embedding, is it?
This is?
The log of the canonical embedding.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. The log of the absolute values of the canonical embedding. Yeah, so the length of an element in the original space is just essentially 2 to the length in the log space, because we just take the log of each coordinate. Okay, so now if I consider my ideal generated by G and I try to look at what happens in the log space. So I have the log of my generator, and now the set of all multiples of G, it's just I'm adding points that were on this half space, so I'm just getting points in here because I'm multiplying, so I'm adding vectors and I get this. And on this line, I got all the log g plus log of some unit. So it's log g times the unit. So it's a generator. So here I will get the log of all the generators, and here I will get the log of other points of my ideal. And so I want to minimize the norm. So the best point I can obtain is this one, the smallest point, which is above this hyperspace. Affine hyperspace. And so, yeah, so we can see if we want to be as close as possible at this point, then the generators, they are good candidates. I mean, one of them should not be too far away from the star. So that's the idea in the Cramer-Ducas-Peikert-Regev algorithm. So how does it work? First, we need to compute a generator of the ideal, because we are not given the ideal with a generator, we are just given a basis of it. So, but this is previous work, this we can do in polynomial quantum time or in sub-exponential classical time. So this, we have it, we use it as a black box. So once I have my generator, what I'm going to do is just, I'm going to add all the units to it and try to find the unit which is as close as possible to the star. And this will be my good generator. Because the first generator I'm computing, it can be everywhere. I mean, we don't know anything about it. So if I want to express it as a lattice problem, in fact, what we really do is we take the logarithm of the generator, we project it on H, and then we solve a closest vector problem on the lattice lambda. So we try to find the point of lambda which is as close as possible to H, and then we get the good generator. So that's the Cramer-Ducas-Peikert-Regev algorithm. Just compute a generator, take the log, project, solve the closest vector problem in the log unit lattice, and you have your good generator. So now there is two questions. The first one is, I've told you that finding closed vector in lattices is hard. And now I'm saying, okay, let's just find the closest vector in the log unit lattice. So maybe we'll just transform one hard problem into another one. And the second question is also, so how close will I be to the star? So what is the density of my log unit lattice, and how close will I be to a unit? And so that's the main part of the CDP algorithm, is so they exhibit a good basis of the log unit lattice. And so remember that we said that if we have a good basis, then the problems become easy. So with a good basis, they can solve the closest vector problem efficiently. Plus, they show that with this good basis, you can always find a point of the log unit lattice at distance at most square root n of any point. So the kind of density of the log unit lattice, any point of the plane is at distance at most square root n of a point of lambda. So it's efficient now, and what we obtain here now is something which is a distance at most square root n of the star, and because we're in the log, it gives us a 2 to the square root n approximation factor in the real space. So this is it for the CDP algorithm. And
but how do they find a good basis of the units? How do they find the good basis of the unit?
Oh, how do they find? In fact, they take cyclotomic units, which is a sub lattice, and they show that, it's conjecture that in power of two cyclotomics, the cyclotomic units are the same. And in general case, it's conjecture that it's not too. The density of lattice is not too sparse, and so this is a good basis. It's almost orthogonal, and it works.
So that's the only bit that's specific to the cyclotomics, right? Because everything
yeah.
else is just
yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, the thing that is specific to cyclotomic, prime power cyclotomic, is that you need cyclotomic units.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how they find the good basis. Okay, so now the question is, here we have a 2 to the square root and approximation factor, and can we do better, maybe, if we increase a bit the complexity? Oh, I forgot to say something, sorry. So now, we have 2 to the square root and approximation factor. Everything here is polynomial time, and here it's polynomial quantum, so that's why we have polynomial here. But if we want to plug in the classical algorithm to find generators, it's 2 to the square root n. So in fact, we are back to the BKZ algorithm. In the classical setting, it's the same as the BKZ algorithm. Okay, so this gives us a 2 to the square root n approximation factor, and now the question is, can we try to reduce this approximation factor, maybe by spending more time on the computation of the elements? And so the first answer to this question is, so if we just focus on generators, like in the CDPR algorithm, we cannot do better than this 2 to the square root n approximation factor. Because, so what they show is the distance between two red points is roughly square root n. And so if you are in a bad situation where your generator is just in the middle of two red points, then the closest generator to the best, the optimal point, will be at distance square root n over 2. So there is some worst cases where we cannot have better than this square root n over 2 distance in 2. So 2 to the square root n in the exponent. So this is if we consider only generators. But we know that at least one of the points of the ideal should be close to the star. So this is something we know. And so maybe it's not a generator, maybe it's just a small multiple of a generator. So now we want to consider also this point. And the important observation is that if this point is close to the star, then it should have a small component on the one axis. So it should be something in h plus some small a times 1. Because otherwise it will be just too far. So what we are doing is, so as before, we take the generator and we project it on h. And so now we are in the middle of two red points and we are not happy. So what we are going to do is we are going to increase the density of the log unit lattice by picking elements with small a component and just adding them, projecting them, and adding them to the log unit lattice. So if we add just one point every time, it won't make a lot of points. So every time we add a point, we can also add the point plus all the units. And so now we have a point which is close to the target. So maybe one vector won't be enough, usually it won't. But we are going to take a lot of vectors with small algebraic norm, project them, and increase the density of the log unit lattice like that. So we do not consider just units anymore, but we also consider elements with small coordinates on the one axis. So I'm going to call L this lattice with all these points. So you can observe that it's not a lattice, I'm lying a bit, because it's just a union of lattices, but maybe it's not a lattice. But this is not a problem, we just embed it by increasing the dimension. So I'm lying, but it's not important. Yeah. And so what we say also is that if we add something like n log n short vectors, then now the density of this lattice will be such that any point of the real space will be a distance at most 1 of any point of the lattice, of some point of the lattice. So we have increased this density and now we can find close points. So if I sum up the algorithm, so what do we do first? We compute elements with small a components. And then we create this lattice L, which consists in the units plus the projection of all these elements with small a component. So this does not depend on my ideal. It just depends on the field I'm working in. Now, when I'm given an ideal, I will compute a generator of it, like previously, using black box algorithm for that. And I'm going to project it. Then I'm going to find the closest vector in L to my target point. I mean, not necessarily the closest. I want something at distance, let's say, n to the alpha for alpha between 0 and 1 half to have all the trade-off between what we had before.
OK, I've got some questions.
Yeah.
Just so I understand what's going on. So when I compute the R with smaller a,
yeah,
that's in the log space.
Yeah.
So an element there is, it's like a product of units. And then, so I take something in the units, so I take an, oh, so what is this? What does this look like in terms of a number field element? Like a
half? Oh, small a in terms of number field elements means small algebraic norm.
Oh, okay. So I just take things are small norm.
Yeah, yeah,
oh, okay.
Yeah, sorry.
Fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Things are small norm. Okay, right. So take things are small norm.
I didn't want it to, but yeah. Algebraic.
Yeah.
So on the one axis, you can see the algebraic norm. So that's why the units are
yeah.
H, and
yeah, yeah. Okay.
The closest you are, this is the smallest the algebraic norm.
Random stuff is small norm.
Yeah, I take random elements with small algebraic norm.
And
so once I have my point in L which is close to my target, then it gives me a point, I mean a multiple of my generator, which is a distance, so because the distance here was n to the alpha, the distance now is 2 to the n to the alpha. The approximation.
Okay, so can you go back to the picture and then explain this again? Now I've got this, this is small norm, I might be able to understand the rest. Okay, so I generate an element with small norm.
Yeah.
Project it.
I'm projecting it on the Lagrange lattice, and I'm in kind of, yeah, I'm adding it to my lattice.
Okay.
So I can also add this plus all the units because it's already in my lattice.
Yeah.
And I'm doing that for a lot of elements. So I'm still hiding stuff here.
Yeah.
Because I mean it's not a lattice, so what you want is you will add some. I mean I can.
So I end up just kind of like I'm taking my generator I'm given, I multiply it by some sort of small norm.
Yeah.
Project it into the unit bit and see whether that's close to some units, something in the units. Subtract that off and then that will give me something that's really quite small.
Yeah. But I mean the way you want to do it is more like a CVP in a lattice.
But I can think that it's like I multiply G1 by the small thing, project that onto that line, and that gives me what I then have to subtract, which will then take me close to where the thing where the generator is. Okay.
And maybe you have to take minus log of G1 here,
because
otherwise you have to subtract the divide, stuff like that. But there should be some minus somewhere, because
it's almost like the classical algorithm for finding class groups anyway, units anyway, yeah?
Yeah, it's very It's very similar to these algorithms.
Because in some sense, what I'm doing is I take this ideal, and then I want to I project it and I solve some lattice problem which is like reduction in the direction in Cohen's kind of notation. And then that tells me what I have to take off. That's, yeah, okay. Okay, cool.
Yeah, so this is the algorithm, and now if I want to know the running time of the algorithm, so computing a generator, we have said that it's polynomial in quantum or sub-exponential in classical time. So the first step that I'm not going to describe how to do that, it's also the same stuff. And so there are two steps that are just writing things, so it's polynomial in N. But the main question that remains is, so how do I solve, again, same problem, how do I solve the closest vector problem in my lattice L?
Why is the first step sub-exponential in classical time?
Yeah.
So it's, in fact, what you do is you compute ideals of small algebraic norm. This you do by factoring small primes.
But it's in K, right? So why do you have to, I mean, K is super simple in your case. Why do you have to, I mean, it's just x to the n plus 1.
Yeah, but generating elements with small algebraic norm, the only way I know to do that is generating ideals with small algebraic norm and then computing a generator of the ideal. I want polynomial algebraic norm, so if I just take an element with polynomial coefficient, usually the algebraic norm will be exponential.
So I should take, I do the half from the curly thing, I take a product of random prime ideals, which I know what they are, then I just want to find a generator of that, yeah? So it's... It's basically, it's doing the same algorithm that you would to find class group. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so when you want to solve the closest vector problem in the lattice, so then let's think about what CDPR did. They had a good basis of it, so it was easy for them. Now, in our case, we don't know of a good basis. So.
But you don't really have a lattice.
Hmm?
But you don't even have a lattice, so it's not.
Yeah, so in fact we do, but we need to work. I mean, it's not the one I've shown you.
Yeah.
But there is a lattice, and it's indeed a CVP in some lattice.
Oh. Okay.
Even if it's not the one I've shown you, you just increase the dimension to make it a lattice.
Okay.
I can write it.
No. Don't I believe you.
It's
just you have your
unit, you have your new vectors.
Okay, yeah.
And you add ones there.
Okay, yeah. I think that was introduced in Bookman's thesis.
Yeah.
Oh, I remember this shit. It's amazing, isn't it?
So we want to solve CVP in a lattice that is not much simpler than the lattice in which we wanted to find short vectors in the origin, in the beginning. But the key observation now is that the lattice L, it does not depend on our ideal lattice. It just depends on the units and some elements with small A coordinates, small algebraic norm. So it just depends on the ring, on the dimension of the ring, basically. So we can preprocess it. So basically, we can compute it first and then just spend exponential time to compute a short basis of it, and then it becomes easy to find the closed vector in this lattice. So in fact, it's not sufficient to find a short basis. So what we are going is we are going to use an algorithm from Larovan, which does exactly closed vector problem with preprocessing, and which tells us that if we have a 2 to the n preprocessing, then we can find a point at distance n to the alpha.
Okay, so my earlier question was about time-space complexity. It's space complexity within this algorithm, but the pre-processing produces something that isn't exponential space.
The preprocessing produces something which takes the same space as the time of the query phase. So it's sub-exponential. I mean, the preprocessing depends on the approximation factor you want to.
Yeah, but that's the time to do the preprocessing, because this is all like, it's like the Voronoi cells takes lots of space, yeah? But the output is just the, isn't the output just the nice basis, which is therefore not?
It's not just a nice basis, because if you just have a nice basis, what you can do is square root n approximation factor for CVP. If you want to do better than square root n, you need more than a good basis. In fact, you need, so what's the algorithm? It's very simple, just compute exponentially many short vectors and then greedily try to remove them. And so if you have a polynomial number of short vectors, what you will get at the end is square root n approximation factor. And if you want bigger of one approximation factor, you need exponential. And you have all the in-betweens. So if you have 2 to the n, 1 minus 2 alpha vectors, you can have n to the alpha approximation factor.
Okay.
So that's where the preprocessing phase comes from. So if we sum up everything, we have approximation factor 2 to the n to the alpha. This is the time for the query phase of the CVP algorithm. So this is the time to compute the closest vector m. And this is the time to compute the numerators, so in quantum or polynomial time, or classical time, so, and preprocessing. And so this gives us this trade-off in the quantum setting. And in the classical setting, because we always have the 2 to the square root n time needed, we have this, this gap here, 2 to the square root n. Okay, so this is it for the algorithm. Let me just say, so what I've presented to you works for cyclotomic rings and principal ideals, but in fact we can make it work for also non-principal ideals. And
what do you mean though? Do you mean that you get a two-element representation that's got the two elements got two small norm, or what is?
You get a basis as a lattice of any ideal.
And the basis is small in some sense.
No, you get any basis. I mean, the input is any basis, and at the end you find a somehow short element in the ideal.
Oh, okay, you find a short element. Okay.
I'm not interested in computing. It's not a basis, just one element. And I mean, it also works in any number of fields, not necessarily cyclotomics. But there is just one change: is that so in any number of field, computing a generator with a classical computer is a bit higher than in cyclotomics. But it's the same. So I also add a slide on how to extend this to non-principal ideals, but I'm not sure. Yeah, I think I can skip this. So the idea is really, I mean, everything we did, in fact, would work almost the same if we had non-principal ideals. But non-principal ideals, maybe it's a bit harder to see what it is. So. Okay, so let me conclude that, again, this has no practical implication. It's just saying that maybe it's easier in ideal lattices to find short vectors. And so we still have some open problems we are working on. So it's a heuristic algorithm, so we try to see if we can remove some heuristic. So we are very happy because Noah Stephens Davidovich told us that we could prove the Larovens algorithm was heuristic, and now we have a proved version of this algorithm, so at least one heuristic is gone. And so there is also, I mean, so this algorithm works for any number field, it's very generic, but maybe for some specific number fields, the lattice L we're constructing has some structure we could exploit. So maybe we could remove the preprocessing or improve the trade-off for specific rings. Sorry. And so as I've said at the beginning, breaking ideal SVP does not break any scheme, so what we should really target is module SVP, but it's much more harder.
There is one scheme of breaks.
Yeah, that's already broken. Well,
yeah.
We had this improvement of Gentry's scheme, the very first one, and this is broken by. Because it really uses generators. It's not based on a ring of three.
Yeah, it's one of the only schemes that really uses
You just seem to lie, right?
So thanks for your attention.